India's financial future. Now, we promised you two fantastic panel discussions tonight, and we have an extremely fabulous, powerful set of panelists for both panels today. So let me introduce the first topic: paperless, presenceless finance, an impending reality, which revolves around why financial institutions and fintech companies should come together to champion the paperless, presenceless channel. Experiences in Western markets, such as the UK, have suggested that volumes for digital issuances increase when paperless replaces the physical loan process. Consumers in India are proving to be nearly as receptive to paperless. This is the mobile internet generation of consumers, and they don't want to stand in queues, submit paperwork, or even visit a physical branch. And they are comfortable transacting 100% online via Aadhaar. So I'd like to invite on stage our first set of panelists, and a big round of applause as I introduce them. To begin with, Arvind Kapil. He is the country head of unsecured loans and home mortgage loans at HDFC. This 22-year banking veteran has also spearheaded a number of digital finance initiatives, such as HDFC's 10-second personal loan product. Anup Bagchi, executive director at ICICI Bank. Prior to this, he was the MD and CEO of ICICI Securities. Under his leadership, the organization won the prestigious Outlook Money India's Best e-Brokerage House Award for 7 consecutive years. He's also been honored with the Asian Banker Promising Young Banker Award. Ramakrishnan S. is the head of retail banking and wealth management at HSBC. Thank you so much for joining us. Subrat Mohanty, the Chief Operating Officer at HDFC Life, where he oversees strategy, operations, health and technology. He joined HDFC Life in 2010 and has led the strategic themes and transformation initiatives of the organization in a fast-changing industry environment. And also Adil Shetty, the co-founder and CEO of BankBazaar. And to moderate this panel, I'd like to invite on stage Naveen Chandani, the Chief Business Development Officer at BankBazaar.
Thank you, Abba. Thank you, Abba. Thanks, everyone. Thanks, panelists, to be a part of the first panel, which we are going to be discussing specifically on why paperless and presenceless. This, as we heard, is our third conclave, and the first two were only around paperless. What we discussed this over the last 2 years, we thought paperless also means presenceless. However, there is a gap between paperless and presenceless. So I would like to kickstart the panel discussion and probably start with you, Arvind. We have seen in the past that your 10-second product has worked very well. But very recently, you have added mutual funds as one of the surrogates. Can you just talk more about that and what you have seen as a take-up?
Okay, what we've really launched is a loan against mutual fund, the digital version. So if you look at it historically, it's not a new product in the industry. It used to take around 6 days or to process it across the industry. So it's just you have mutual funds, you can take a loan against it. As simple as that. Take 6 days to do it. If you want money today from a customer's point of view, you have two options. Either to take a loan, which will take you 6 days, or redeem. Obviously, because it takes 3 days to redeem, commonsensically a customer would redeem it. What we've really done is, and it's got obviously a regulator in the game, so to make it paperless was far more challenging. The 10 seconds loan, which we did in personal loan, was absolutely regulation, but it didn't have an intermediary lien marking process. So in this, we spoke to CAMS, which is part of the mutual fund, and we created a product keeping the customer at the center at HDFC Bank, where we've created a product where the customer can take a loan against his mutual fund in 3 minutes, paperless. What it really did is, you had the numbers go almost 15x within the first month. And we're expecting that to go 10x. So you can see the kind of scale I'm talking right. Of a product which is not new. But if you just made that paperless, the adoption rate shot up n number of times. And that's It's an absolutely secure product to that extent. We had a couple of presentations to the regulator, and like I think I heard Mr. Mundra say, we had to call
With your teams. And straight-through processing has been the mantra with ICICI Bank. Can you tell us what do you see in the horizon? Because I think a single visit kind of a paperless journey already exists, but what do you think is the next phase?
The biggest opportunity at this point of time lies in just taking out the paper and using technology where there is no human judgment involved. So I think products like this, loan against shares, loans against mutual fund, essentially there is no human judgment involved in credit underwriting. If there is no human judgment involved in credit underwriting, you just have to make it STP. Because there is no value addition happening in the whole chain. That is number one. Number two, the biggest OPEX takeout will also happen when you look at the full process and you see that there is no value addition being happening in the various processes. Because this whole issue about financial inclusion, low ticket, etc., basically it comes to two things. It comes to a risk on the lending side, but more importantly, what is the cost of serving the customer? And we have to be relentless about reducing the cost of serving the customer. If you cannot reduce the cost of serving the customer, then it becomes a load. Anything which is a burden, you can't take it too far. So it's very, very important that you look at the full value chain. So for example, on the lending processes, you know, how do you get the acquisition, how do you get the sanction? And if it is unsecured, you know, then, so there is, so unsecured, which is why things like, you know, there, you know, 10 second hour InstaPL, which is instantaneous, which is a similar product. The thing is that if you can underwrite it centrally, okay, using algos, using whatever, you indeed can make it completely paperless. Secondly, if your collateral is safe and liquid, like in loan against shares or in loan against DMAT, you can actually again make it because risk is not getting sort of borne by that. But the moment you make it different kind of collateral, like in a mortgage, you know, it's not a straight line process because the collateral, so while you can do the income estimation on an online basis using the digital ecosystem which has evolved, you still cannot make the collateral system completely online. But I must say that in many cases, land records are getting digitized. It is becoming better and better. You know, in some states, I will say that almost 90-95% of the land records are digitized. Some states is 70, some states is lower. The moment you reduce the cost, your risk reduces. The moment your risk reduces over a period of time, the credit flow will happen towards that. If the credit flow happens towards that, your margin will reduce and it does good. Essentially, this whole STP, I think the framework that one must really think is there a human judgment involved? You know, can you estimate income? Or do you have a collateral, you know, which is liquid and you can redeem? Or are the other attendant ecosystem developed digitally so that you can have a full fix on the risk? Because if you have a full fix on the risk, then it's a different thing. Now on, let's say, you know, if you look at physical free, I mean, you don't go there. The issue is that, you know, we must be very, very mindful that when you do complete straight through, there are a lot of risk when you are doing lending. For example, today, you know, let's say at time t is equal to 0, your CIBIL score will be good, your fixed income obligation ratio, whatever, you know, XYZ parameters are very, very good. But for whatever extent, if somebody is gaming the CIBIL score, and CIBIL score can be gamed, you know, credit bureaus can be gamed, it's not that they cannot be gamed, and you are doing completely online STP, you know, and you are lending, you see a CIBIL score, just a CIBIL score, which in my mind is a lagged indicator, it's not a lead indicator, and you start to deliver, you know, without having any other KYC input, because KYC input can come from liabilities, KYC input can come from social media, KYC input can come from many, many, credit underwriting inputs can come from many, many places. So this credit underwriting is an important thing. You know, this completely straight through processing using single variable of, let's say, only credit bureau, which is a lagged indicator, I think one should be cautious. One should be cautious. I don't think we should just throw caution to the wind, you know, just because the reason there are brakes, you know, in a vehicle is to increase the average speed.
Right.
You know, and it's very, very critical that we keep it in mind. You know, I must also share, for example, now a lot of income tax returns have come, you know, in this phase, lots. And all of them, you know, are small ticket, 2 lakh, 2.5 lakh, 3 lakh income. Lot of income tax returns have come. Now imagine, I don't know what is the quality of those income tax SSCs. You know, what kind of returns have come after demonetization? I have no idea. But they are completely online. Now you pick that plus XYZ plus another variable, and you lend to them. And you don't have a collection mechanism, you have a problem. So I'm saying, let's be mindful of the risk as such. We haven't seen many cycles. You know, we have to be mindful of the cycles also. Of course, you should drive fast, but I would say also exercise caution in some of these things.
Thanks, thanks. I think a theme is emerging. Consumers want it. We have seen they have picked it up paperless. We have seen that we would need to have a different journey in terms of managing risk. How from the source, different sources, we can get different kinds of information that can actually be put into an algo and then actually give a loan or a credit card so that the risk is managed. I think you're right. The online consumer now requires to be underwritten in a very different way. I think online, the entire process is different, and the risk management is also going to be very different. Puneet, the two bankers are talking about how we are seeing the growth and how risk can be managed online. And I think all of us understand and appreciate that paperless is yet not presenceless in the banking. But on the insurance industry, you guys have, been pioneers in presenceless. Other than if it is a life insurance, which specifically has a medical requirement, which is physical. How you have seen online specifically grow, and what are your thoughts that we can learn from the insurance industry and actually translate it into the banking industry?
I'm very glad that you are saying there are thoughts from insurance industry which can go to the banking. Because when we started our digital journey, we actually started looking at banking as a model and tried to innovate on that. But jokes apart, see, the thought process is very simple. Irrespective of the product, if you can make two or three things simple, life will be better. And online is means to an end. A, if you can make life convenient for the customer, if you can make life convenient for the person offering the product, whether it is underwriting or whether it is, and in the bargain, if you improve efficiency and if you improve value both for the consumer as well as for the manufacturer, things will work out. So online was means to an end for us. In the insurance industry, we have faced tremendous changes, whether it is regulatory, whether it is ecosystem. So there was a point when it became mandatory, literally, for us to become far more efficient. So necessity, honestly, was the mother of invention. And we realized that actually, as you went down this path, it was actually a virtuous path. As you go down this path, you start realizing that finally our business is also about underwriting. Like you give a loan, there is credit underwriting. In our business, there is both financial and medical underwriting. For which, what do you want? You want consumers to give you honest, truthful, relevant data. That is all. What we started realizing is that when the consumer is dealing with the manufacturer directly, the chances of the consumer giving honest, truthful, relevant data go up significantly, number one. Number two, at the same time as the ecosystem is evolving, whether it's through the India stack and so many other things that are evolving, it is also possible to get a fairly good idea of the persona of the consumer through the environment itself. And when you put the two things together along with the rapidly developing data analytics capabilities, not only do things become far more efficient for us, the value proposition for the customer also increases dramatically. And as I said, that leads to a virtuous cycle. And my view is we are still pretty much at the beginning of that cycle.
Thanks. Thanks, Puneet. So it looks like that in the insurance industry, risk profiling using alternate kind of source of data is working. And I think that's something which, I think the banking industry could work for, learn from. Ramki, if I can, get you on board. HSBC is present in various markets, and Bank Bazaar has been working with you in various markets. But what do you believe? And I think Anup touched upon costs, economies, margins. Have you seen that in other markets? What has been your experience at HSBC for online digital sourcing?
So let me first start by saying that I'm sort of surrounded by, let's say, four gentlemen who probably have more branches in Bandra than I have in all of India. So clearly the need for digital is far more felt for a bank like HSBC. But look, the fact is, whether it's in India or overseas, and since we do have a lot of digital spend across the globe, just as an example, our global CEO has actually announced that he will spend $15 billion on digital.
Wow.
Between now and 2020. That's a lot of money. And Asia-Pacific specifically leads this entire sort of spend. And in Asia-Pacific, people are starting to see that the India market, in addition to China, is also a significant player. And I must thank the regulator and the government on this and the bureau. So these are stuff that is giving the organization a lot of comfort, saying this is the kind of market that one would want to invest in. Clearly, it's a little early to say the benefits that you can get if I were to just, if you wanted certain numbers. But look, it's the right thing for the client, exactly like I think what Puneet said. It's the right thing for the client. And the clients are not comparing HSBC with, let's say, an HDFC or an ICSA or any other organization in the banking space. They're comparing me with an Uber. They're comparing me with a Zomato or a Swiggy. Just imagine going to Swiggy and saying, I'd like a pizza, but you know what? Let me download a form. Let me fill up the form, call up Swiggy and say, please come and pick up the form. It's not going to work. So they've stopped comparing banks against each other because they are so used to that mobile phone, and that's really what they want to go after. Very recently, we shut down half our network. We were 50 branches till 3 years back. We shut down 24 of them. And I remember my CEO talking about this, and he said very simple. He said, we have 450,000 square feet of retail space, and all we need is 18 square inches.
Super.
So that is really the kind of way forward, not just for Indian banks, but foreign banks as well. We definitely see a lot of merit in this, and I think when we work together with the regulator, with organizations like Bank Bazaar, aggregators, I think there's a lot to gain here.
Thanks. I think you touched on two important points that registered. One is, reach, because of the limit physical presence that you have. And the other one, you spoke about the consumer who's already experiencing, great service in e-commerce on the app or on the mobile phone. That actually leads me to, Subrat, to ask you, again, being an insurance company, you have grown your presence digitally. How do you see that quality of portfolio performing? That's another insight that will actually, again, be important for us when we actually do not only paperless, but even presence-less. How is that quality of that portfolio performing versus the offline portfolio?
Right. So, the quality of portfolio depends on a few things. And regardless of whether it's offline or online, you possibly get that quality if those parameters are met. First is if the customer truly understands the product he or she is buying. And it tends to be that if the customer is online and they're, doing the research themselves and trying to understand what the product features are, comparing it, which is easily done online without intermediation, then the customer does tend to understand what product he or she is buying and why this product is better than the other product, which takes away any surprises in future, and therefore it tends to be better quality. It's not to say that there are offline intermediaries who don't do this, but that proportion is smaller. Whereas in online, it tends to be higher because the customer is pretty much going in with his or her eyes open. So that's one. So you need to be clear about what product you're buying, and you need to be clear about what the features of the product are. And the second is the quality of disclosure. Self-disclosures do tend to be better than disclosures when somebody else is filling up forms for you.
Right.
Because somebody who's actually filling up form for you has somewhat of a conflicted interest in getting that particular form filled up in a certain way, which allows you to actually purchase that product faster. And therefore, if you do self-disclosure, and we see the moment we start tele-underwriting, the moment we start underwriting at the point of sale with the customer himself filling information up, we find actually the level of disclosure increase, which initially tends to sort of surprise us because we thought by giving it to the customer, we reduce the possibility of the customer going for a medical or going for, you know, an additional test or an additional check. But the customer self-discloses, which actually then again, in the long run, improves the quality of the book. So yes, absolutely, the online, the features of online, you know, business are of the kind which improves the quality of the book, and that's clearly visible for insurers by a margin.
Great, great. So looks like that even on the underwriting, self-disclosures, people are becoming more aware. People are realizing that, you know, if somebody as an agent would say, I'm in good health, just tick it because of a vested interest, that doesn't happen. That's great. Adil, if I can to share your thoughts. It's been 10 years at BankBazaar, you know, creating a neutral platform. Collaboration is the key. We heard, you know, the seniors speak, Mr. Mundra as well as Mr. Kant, talk about fintech and financial institutions collaborating. What are your thoughts in a neutral way that it works? How does it work? How it will actually help the ecosystem?
Right. So the first question I think we used to get 10 years ago, and you know, the investors in the room, was that would banks want to partner? Would insurers want to partner? I think the great thing is we get pushed by everyone on the stage saying do more business because we want to grow together. So I think that speaks for itself. I think there are two data points which are playing out. One is we're bringing new customers into the fold. So I think it's very different, and it complements the existing bank mobile app because 90% of BankBazaar business is new business. And I think here is a strategically integrated data-based model in which to collaborate. So rather than buying clicks off the internet, which is what happens on the top 200 sites in India, here's a way we can integrate and solve together. So I think the answer is the support we've gotten on this stage.
Super. In fact, that leads me to the next question, because it's exciting that, you know, the existing bank customers have that 10-second product. What, Arvind, are you doing with the new-to-bank customers who may not have already a KYC document with you? What are your thoughts around that, and any plans around that?
No, I think we're working on something on the open market. But I think, as Anup said, it's important that you walk these roads keeping the risk in mind. You're running large balance sheets. You will run with distributions which have, say, 4,900 branches running. When you launch something, you know, pilot is one thing. When you run things on scale, you've got to be very sure of it. And it has to be rock solid, testing the criteria for regulation, testing what really happens when it hit the customer. You don't want something to be launched where you've got to go to and fro. So yes, that's going to be something which we are working on, and something I think the industry wants to get that piece right. But you must remember that you're talking about a product which is also unsecured.
Right.
So I think we have to walk a little more carefully on it. But we're bullish on it. Most of the digital products that we've launched on the lending side has seen massive scale. So we are committed to that, committed to our customers to make that happen.
Super, super. Anup, if I'll get you in, you had mentioned about risk. And what we heard online versus offline, especially in the insurance industry, very clearly, you know, self-declaration. The KYC, which is, I think, what we have been discussing about. Why are, say, somebody with feet on street versus online in the banking industry, which is a, you know, one-click submission, either from source or uploading. What are your thoughts around that? Because you're doing both. You're seeing both sides. Because of the regulation, you're doing that one visit also. But what are you seeing in terms of online versus offline uploading and authentication of KYC documents or income documents?
I think online is super because you know, you also get other details which you can then check with the details that has been either given by the customer, or you can self-populate, etc., etc. So I think that part is without doubt sort of very, 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 very good. On the offline, I think the big issue still remains is, you know, manipulated documents. And it's it's a big issue. I mean, and it is very cheap, incidentally. It's not very expensive as well, and there are many business models which run on that. So there is a big business model versus business model fight. And I think if once you shift online, and you online authenticate, I think there is nothing sort of better than that.
Super.
So I think, you know, this move towards, we should increase the limits. I don't think we should just sort of take it out. But it should certainly increase the limits of you know, physicalness as well. I think it, and we have seen that, you know, the risk on online authenticated, good credit underwriting with other input parameters. I think the portfolio has done quite well. I don't think there's any
Super.
Delta between the two.
Great. Good to hear that portfolio is running well as, you know, there is an option that everyone should actually, in the next panel, discuss of how to increase the limits. Also, I think the fraud that happens offline versus online. Puneet, I'll get you in over here. You spoke about data in the last answer. We have been working together as partners, and data being a key differentiator and a lot of data now available online. How is you know, ICICI Prudential Life looking to use that data to create that one-click checkout? If you can share some thoughts on that.
Data, while it sounds very exciting, is a commodity which has to be handled with extreme care, handled with sensitivity, because you have to balance the convenience part with the security part. We have been talking a lot about presence-less, paperless, you know, using data. In reality, as a society, as regulators, as policymakers, as manufacturers of products, ultimately, what do we want? We want as many people as possible to buy the products that we want. If I look at it from a regulatory or a policymaker perspective, they call it financial inclusion. We call it, you know, new to bank or new to insurance customer. Basically, expand the base. In my mind, using publicly available data on a secure platform, using something like a mobile with the kind of broadband penetration we have, actually is the best way to achieve financial inclusion. It democratizes the entire process. Now, today, if, for example, if you're a banking customer, any bank, depending on which category you are, if you're a private banking customer or a privileged banking customer or a retail customer or a corporate banking customer, you will be treated differently. But if you are transacting on the mobile using whatever the relevant data, you will be treated equal. Whether you are somebody very important like Mr. Mundra or Mr. Amit Thapkant or a commoner like me, we all will be treated the same. And that is where I think the power of all of these things comes together. And that is why it is also incumbent upon us, while we see this benefit, to actually use this in a responsible manner. And finally, you know, it is also a question of competitiveness of an industry. It is a function of how much demand is getting generated. The more the demand, the cheaper, you know, things will be, how frictionless we make the process. So all of these things have to keep happening simultaneously. So, you know, several of us spoke about the fact that forms had to be filled. Ramki spoke about it on Swiggy. If you have to fill a form and get things done, it won't happen. That's precisely the case in everything else. While we all know the importance of KYC, it is critical. All of us, those who are in financial services, we know our job is risk management. And actually, that is the role that KYC was supposed to play. But unfortunately, KYC became know your document, not know your customer. Because we are only looking at documents and which, as we discussed, easily manipulated. So if you really convert into actually know your data, and if you think these are authentic, reliable sources, whether it is UID, whether it is NSDL, or, you know, whether it is credit bureaus, it helps us to cut down a lot of processes, both from the customer end as well as our underwriting process. And, you know, what was supposed to be perhaps a 10-click process, you know, yes, one click is great, it is ideal. In our case, perhaps has become more like a 3 or 4-click process. Of course, we aspire to make it a one-click process. But that is clearly the journey on which we are on. And clearly, there are benefits for all concerned, for customers, for manufacturers, for society, for regulators.
Thanks for sharing that. And, you know, we discussed cost as a benefit. And you said, hey, we don't need to reach through physical branches. But how has the portfolio, say on the card side, performed in terms of spends, in terms of activation? Because eventually the card industry, you know, issuers make money if people spend and activate. It's not just having a card in the wallet.
So, like I said, it's a little early to look at, you know, is it a completely a different kind of spend and activation? But early in sort of indicators lead me to believe that definitely the activation rate is a lot higher, one. The spend, if I look at, let's say, in the first 3 months as compared to the spend on the first 3 months of an offline card is also much higher. But I also believe it's because a digitally sourced card or digitally sourced loan is something where the client has asked for it and gone and done it on his own. There's no one pushing that product. The minute someone's pushing a product, you may or may not use it. But if someone who's gone and sourced it digitally is doing that a lot more. More importantly, a digitally sourced card, we must also appreciate, gets spent digitally as well. And because our ecosystem is where a lot of purchases still are happening on the Amazons and the Flipkarts and the Snapdeals, and a lot more needs to be done there, the day we're also able to develop that ecosystem of spending digitally, that ties in very well with sourcing digitally, and I think then we've got the kind of a best thing. The only thing we need to remember is it's digital is not, you can't do anything pure digital in banking. We did a research which said that what is the one thing that determines which bank you choose? And you will be surprised. The answer was the presence of a physical branch. And then the next question was, when was the last time you visited the branch? The answer is never. So you need the branch because it's your money, but I will do everything digitally.
Wow. And you guys are spending $15 billion in the next 3 years for digital, so that's big. Subrat, I'll bring you in. And, you know, we've been working together very closely. And, you know, I was, you know, very, very happy to know that you had a team which was a fintech team that you actually insourced, you could say. And even the way they would dress, I think, was different at one time. But keeping the consumer at the center, what made you do it? And what has been the consumer response after you got this team to, you know, keep the consumer in the center?
Right. So the dress thing is still a problem. No matter how much they undress, they think they can further undress. So, which I have no idea why that's important for any fintech company to have a dressing sense which is very different from ordinary. But listen, we had a few things to sort of worry about. One, we were noticing that customers are starting to aggregate on newer platforms. You know, Bank Bazaar, 420 million, you know, visitors. And there are multiple such platforms where customers are aggregating. And we wanted to modularize the entire insurance product and service in a manner that regardless of what the customer is coming and doing on any of these sites, if there is a specific insurance need, not the entire product, they should be able to engage, whether it's just understanding a product or whether they just want to pay a premium or they want to actually just figure out their wellness score, so on and so forth. And so it was important for us to modularize and make it available in a manner that any of these new age aggregators are able to include any one of these in their journey. So that's one. Second is data. We have our own data. We have partners with whom we work. All of this works with the consent of the customer. But how do I make sure that data is available, which is contextual, which can be used at that point of time, and the customer does not have to repeat? You know, when you want to buy insurance, you really have to be extremely motivated to purchase insurance. It's not something that becomes quite easy because you have to fill up a lot of fields and then you have to do the underwriting and so on and so forth. A lot of that data is actually easily available, and it's available with any of these partners, or you could develop proxies around it. But it's not easy to do it unless you actually have a team which understands all of this in a very sort of, in a fairly salient manner, and then actually go out and do it. And lastly, we wanted to bring some of the technology tools which we could actually use in order to make all of this happen, whether it is a cloud platform or whether it is using some of the, artificial intelligence tools and things of that kind. which again, it was important that we have it in-house than just use vendors to do it. So we brought all of that, and that's how it has succeeded. We've already got about 30-odd people now in that team. We have now a data lab sitting, centers sitting out of Bangalore. Again, they don't want to sit in any of our offices or branches, so we have a co-working space. But you know, you need to give some of those allowances before you start pulling them back. But initially, you give them, let that work, and then we'll see how that goes forward.
Sure, thanks. If I can get Arvind, you in. We have been reading a lot about the leadership, you know, change in terms of thought process, how fintech is important to HDFC, and you have done a lot of partnerships over the years. What are your thoughts of when it started and how HDFC is collaborating specifically with fintech, again, keeping the consumer in the center?
Like, I think like every other player, we are partnering with multiple players. Like I said in the start, it's important to learn with every digital product that you do. For example, any digital product is showing one more significant thing is, unlike the physical world, you know, if you get into the semi-urban and rural stretch, the geographies are very expansive. And if you really want to scale up business there, you cannot afford to have that much manpower. So your operating costs won't justify. So invariably, companies are going to be shy. And you need sort of a financial inclusion. You need the villages covered. Now, how do you really do that? So in digital, some of the products that we've launched, we've been surprised that locations like Leh Ladakh got active. Locations like Baramulla got active. Locations like, you know, outskirts or Nagpur, where we may not have a physical manpower, have got active on scale, have right. got active on a monthly recurring basis, which is not some pattern which we saw as consistently earlier. So I think just fintech alone insights are not going to be enough. We're going to constantly learn out of the experiments we've done. We've got to connect the dots on how you run these things at scale.
Right.
Otherwise, they're just going to be boutique shops.
Right.
So I think for us, it's very important that any initiative on digital runs on scale, gets you the customer delight on scale, and gets you the kind of operating costs that you're looking for.
Super, super. Anup, again, you know, being in the banks and ICICI, again, always being, you know, innovative, trying to come out with an Insta card or, you know, a virtual card. What are your thoughts around that? Because again, consumer may be shopping online, wants a credit card. And I know, you know, discussing with your teams that they are looking to create something that can be given in the flow. Any thoughts of what your plans are? How is that working out? Will that become a reality? Does the customer require it?
There are a couple of things which digital allows you, which offline doesn't allow you, and that is to, you know, create the cost in a sachet format. And so, you know, you don't have to have an inventory, you don't have to have all those stuff, and you can. So the essential issue is that, you know, do you have a big lab and an inventory of problems to solve? And, you know, taking from Arvind, our view also is that, see, we have to solve problems. We have to first figure out the customer insights. Then we have to figure out how do we resolve those issues. And if fintechs are attacking on a problem, how do we attack the problem? But finally, we'll have to absorb it all in the organization for scale. Digital allows you to experiment at marginal cost. And if it works, works. If it doesn't work, you can kill it very easily. There is no issue. Physicality has a minimum economic size issue, which digital doesn't have. I think it's very, very critical. Because then you can operate really with very, very high operating leverage. So once you have a base, you can operate. So it actually changes the whole economics of the way you run the business. You don't have to have, you know, fixed costs as such. So I think that is very, very exciting. Because you don't have to have inventory, you don't have to have costs. You can increase the cost, you can experiment, you can take it back, you can again put it back. You can use data, you can attack a set of customers, you can, you know, take learnings, put it back. I think it's the whole sort of creativity that comes in the business. You can really fly with digital, and you know in ICICI Direct, which is fully digital, I can tell you that you can really fly. The freedom that data and digital and analytics gives you, nothing can match.
Super. Great to hear. What we'll do is possibly one question to all three of you before we close. It's the same question, but we spoke about how consumer wants it, how underwriting could be, you know, created specifically for this digital customer, reaches there. We spoke about possibly higher spends, active customers. But the key is digital acquisition. There's a cost to it. Maybe if the three gentlemen can just talk about, there's a cost to offline, obviously, sourcing and acquisition. It's prone to manipulation or fraud, yes, but there's a cost to digital acquisition also. So maybe, Puneet, I start with you. What are your thoughts around that?
Obviously, it depends on the extent of the demand that exists in the product and the extent of the value or service that the product offers. So, for example, today, obviously, the cost of acquiring a lead digitally through an inorganic, you know, through the Google leads or whatever, is obviously very high. But the reason is very simple, because demand has not yet reached that. So if demand explodes, for example, that cost will automatically come down. And until that happens, what we need to do as manufacturers to keep ensuring that we keep updating both our content and our value proposition to the extent that it starts making sense for the consumer. And also, once the consumer comes, it's not as if, you know, whether it is, you know, on your platforms or indeed on any of our platforms, organic platforms, the number of consumers who come is indeed very high. So either because of content or value proposition, or maybe the process is still not simple or frictionless enough. So once the customer comes, if we can get him or her to close it in a jiffy, it will obviously improve this whole cost angle.
Thanks. Ramki, yours, because like you said, digital is the key, but...
No, very simple. Clearly, digitally sourced, the acquisition cost per unit will be much lower, but you'll have to exclude the initial investment that's required for it. But eventually, it'll go lower. But the point is, it's not about cost. It's about the value that you're giving to the client. So when the value is significant, and it's again, not just about acquisition, it's about how do you service that account after you acquire him. Now, you acquire him digitally and then you ask him to go to the branch for everything, doesn't work. So digital is end-to-end.
Great. Subrat, your
thoughts? I believe cost of digital acquisition is going up quite dramatically and might soon sometimes equal or even exceed sometimes the physical acquisition, at least the ones that we do in through the non-organic routes, right? So I think the important point is how efficient are you with conversion, so that finally the actual, you know, throughput that you're getting, which actually in digital can be quite high, way higher than the inefficient reasons why we possibly might not get that kind of conversion in offline. I think that can reduce the cost. Demand can definitely reduce the cost. And which also, you know, comes back to the point that if you have a strong brand offline, then you will continue to actually get, you know, the organic route leads, which are actually cheaper, and which is why some of us do build the brand, and you build the brand as well, because that makes you to get out of the tyranny of the cost per click, which I think is important as well.
Thanks. One question, how can an ecosystem be created? And we spoke about, you had a slide up there, win-win proposition, customer and the financial institutions. And how can FinTech collaborate to make this win-win happen, Adil?
I think we covered it in everything we discussed, Naveen, collaboration. So I think we have a ton of data. The consumer tech is ready. There are 420 million customers on the platform. We need to collaborate to find a way how we can give them a reason to close the transaction online. And I think paperless and presenceless is going to be the game changer, wherein the consumer won't think twice about not completing on the platform. And I think the essential opportunity is to play to our strengths and really, really turbocharge this industry.
So with that, I know the time is up. It's blinking over here. I would like to thank each of the panelists for their insights. I hope everyone found this interesting. Very clearly, I think it's the consumer at the center. I think there might be a requirement of looking at risk differently and how to underwrite that customer. Reach undoubtedly is there. But the important thing is that the paperless also needs to become presenceless. So with that, thank you everyone. Appreciate it.